Good evening, welcome to Left, Right and Centre. I'm Vishnu Shom. Well, a meeting today at the veteran politician Sharad Pawar's house in Delhi drew outsized attention over reports of third front manoeuvres ahead of the 2024 polls. There was a clarification, this is no third front. But that said, it did feature this meeting, eight parties including Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress, the Aam Aadmi Party, also the Left. Now the Congress was missing, even though several leaders had been invited. The former Union Minister Yashwant Sinha said he'd asked Sharad Pawar to host the gathering to, buy his outfit, the Rashtra Manch, to debate current events. So what is this all about? That's our first debate. Was this just a meeting of like-minded political leaders, or is this perhaps the first step, a prelude to something larger ahead of the 2024 elections? Some say it's a damn squib, but was there something there that needs to be looked at for the future? Also coming up on the show, Jet Airways set to fly again by the end of this calendar year. That's truly fantastic news. Tonight we speak to Ashish Chacharia, the resolution manager appointed to save the airline. He did. It's now owned by a coalition of international players. We're also joined by delighted Jet Airways staffers eager to get their jobs back. But first, let's take a look at this meeting of leaders of eight political parties at Sharad Pawar's house in Delhi. What was this all about? So there was the NCP, the Trinamool, the National Conference, the Samajwadi Party, the RLD, the Aam Aadmi Party, CPI, CPM. They attended the meeting. As you can see, all these leaders gathered around to talk. But what was this, just a talk shop, or was this, a talk shop with the objective of something more substantial? The goal, they said, was part of a need to provide an alternative vision for the country. Did they actually get around to the process of starting to look at that? Perhaps too early, but Yashwant Sinha will set up a team to prepare such a vision. It has been announced, and our vision will be inclusive and positive. It will not be confrontational. The meet was called by Yashwant Sinha, not by Sharad Pawar. It wasn't a political meet. So that's interesting. On the one hand, they talk about a new vision for the country, but in the same breath, they say it's not a political meet. No Congress boycott. We called all like-minded people, is what has been said. So what exactly was this meeting all about? That's our first topic this evening. KC Singh, the former diplomat, strategic affairs expert, was one of those invited to the meeting. He joins us now. Ghanshyam Tiwari, the spokesperson of the Samajwadi Party, also with us, and Mahesh Verma, the BJP leader. So let me come to you first, Ambassador Singh. What exactly was this meeting all about? Was this a prelude to, well, a third front, but you can't call it a third front?
Look, Rashtra Manch was created 3 years ago before the last parliament election in 2018, January. And the intention was that it should be a party-neutral forum or platform, which is not political, but it discusses political issues. It's issue-based. But what happened is very little interest was shown. Other parties did come in. Congress used to be represented then, first by Manish Tiwari and then Renuka Chaudhary-ji. She was even there in Patna when Mr. Yashwant Sinha resigned. So it's not that Congress has not been associated. I think what has changed this time is that Mr. Yashwant Sinha is now with the TMC, and Mr. Sharad Pawar decided to host it. So that kind of gave it a political color. But essentially, the aims remain the same, that we focus on issues. We keep the focus there. Like, for instance, I and Jayant Singh, RLD chairman, RLD chairperson or president, we focused on the farmers' issue. We said farmers are right here on the borders of Delhi. And we requested Mr. Sharad Pawar that you are one of the leaders of the farming interests of the farmers in Maharashtra. And there should be an All India support that should be available to farmers. And all the farmers all over the country should really be interested in the subject. So this way, other issues were raised. Price rise was raised. Economy was raised. So then a decision was made. Let's expand it. The two co-chair, they said, let's expand it. Let's talk to other parties. Let them come in as parties or let individuals come in.
Okay.
But essentially, let's be issue-based. What is current? What is it that is of interest to the people today, and present options on it?
Okay. Mahesh ji, is pe aapka reaction kya hai? Aap ye isko third front samajhte, fourth front, jo bhi front ho, aap usko ek, ek collection of opposition parties samajhte, ye koi beginning step hai BJP ke khilaaf koi morcha banwane ke liye?
Ye confront hai. Ye koi front nahi hai.
Ye confront hai, koi front nahi hai. Achha.
एग्जैक्टली आप ये जो है इस तरह के फ्रंट, जब ये इस तरह की कवायद जो है आपने विष्णु जी अब से नहीं बहुत पहले से देखी, शरद पवार जी का जो एक तरह से अगर मैं कहूँ तो उनकी राजनीतिक पृष्ठभूमि में जब मैं देखता हूँ तो ये चीज़ मुझे ज़्यादा दिखाई देता है कि उन्होंने जोड़ तोड़ और मरोड़ की राजनीति से अपनी चीज़ों को शुरू की थी। अब सवाल उठता है कि आज की डेट में इस तरह का जो ये कवायद शुरू हुई है इसका कोई मोदी का विरोध करना ही अगर इनके एकजुट होने का कारण है तो ये समझ में आता है, लेकिन सवाल है कि मुद्दे कहाँ हैं। आज करोना है, इस महाकाल में, इस महाविपत्ति में ये इस तरह के राजनीतिक अवसरवादिता को आप क्या कहेंगे? ये देशहित में है, जनहित में है, क्या ये जनता को कभी अपील करेगी? एक बात। दूसरी बात कि सवाल यह है कि कांग्रेस ऐसे अभियान को जो पहले दिन पलीता लगाती है, कि अभी मैं सुन रहा था किसी कांग्रेस प्रवक्ता को कि कांग्रेस के बिना जो है इस तरह का, कांग्रेस नेतृत्व के बिना इस तरह की कोई भी कवायद, इस तरह की कोई भी पॉलिटिकल इंजीनियरिंग, इस तरह का कोई पॉलिटिकल प्रयास जो है वो बेमानी है इस देश में। तो सवाल यह है कि कांग्रेस अगर ये कह के और इस तरह के गठबंधन से अपनी दूरी करती है तो महाराष्ट्र में क्या होगा?
महेश जी, वन सेकंड, लेट्स टॉक अबाउट दिस मीटिंग स्पेसिफिकली। घनश्याम तिवारी ऑफ द समाजवादी पार्टी जॉइंस अस। Ghanshyam ji, the fact is that the Congress wasn't there. You'd reached out to them, Sharad Pawar ji had reached out to them, Yashwant Sinha had reached out to them, they chose not to attend. So, I mean, if you are looking for a collection of views on current issues, without the Congress, how does it work for opposition leaders?
Good evening, Vishnu. The foundation of Rashtra Manch, as it was founded by Yashwant Sinha ji in 2018 on January 30th, is built upon building an open mic among political parties who are like-minded and have similar ethos. Leaders of Congress Party, be it Renuka Chaudhary ji or Manish Tiwari ji, have been participants at Rashtra Manch on a regular level. It was just that the meeting happened in restrictive pandemic times with short notice. So it led to rumors that some party was not invited or parties from various South Indian states are not invited. As a result, the first consensus output of the meeting was that Rashtra Manch has to be an open mic for political parties coming together, leaders coming together, people from social organizations who have done lifetime work on important issues coming together. And as a result, the next meeting you will see that these rumors will be put to rest and leaders from all political parties, like-minded political parties, will be invited. It is an effort that both Yashwant Sinha ji and Sharad Pawar ji spoke about, that Congress party, other parties should be invited. This is a open forum, restrictive forum.
Let me go back to Mr. KC Singh. Was there any talk of the 2024 elections and how the opposition needs to come together to form a credible challenge to the BJP?
No, absolutely not. Nobody is looking that far into the future.
What about the UP elections?
They're looking at the issues. Obviously, with Mr. Jayant Chaudhary there, that was mentioned, what are the issues which are there? And the farmers' agitation is very much there in UP and Punjab. So that's why I raised it. You can't escape that. And if we are talking of pandemic, who preponed the Kumbh? Who was the one who had big rallies in West Bengal? Where was the COVID at that point?
No, so but Mr. Singh, I completely understand the points you're making. I'm just trying to understand what the objective was. Several senior leaders, 8 political parties, you know, experts like you, meeting just for the sake of a conversation over several cups of tea? Or is there a political objective, you know, which underlies this meeting?
Look, it is not, Rashtra Manch is not a political organization, but it discusses political issues.
Okay.
And it wants to take a lead on issues that are defining contemporary political reality. And what is, you bring up the issues, you try getting people on board and get as many as you can. And that is the way. And that should be the narrative which if the opposition is not presenting those narratives, somebody has to present those narratives, because the people require that counterpoint. They require alternative points of view. So this organization is simply providing an opportunity to different organizations, including political parties or non-political entities, to come together and provide, because 5-6 of the people were not from the political field or political party, or 7-8 of them. So therefore, it is a combination of ideas coming in, points of view on what are the existential or contemporary problems that the nation is facing.
All right.
And therefore, what are the possible solutions?
Okay. Now,
if BJP feels it is a critique of the government, well, in a democracy, there is bound to be critique of the government. It's not illegal to critique a government. They should be prepared for it. But that doesn't mean that everybody who critiques the government is essentially anti their leader or anti them. This is not enmity. This is simply how a democracy functions.
So, Mahesh ji, KC Singh ji saaf saaf taur se keh rahe ki ye koi मतलब ये इस मीटिंग में कोई एजेंडा नहीं था, ये यूपी इलेक्शंस या राष्ट्र नेशनल इलेक्शंस के बारे में नहीं था, सिर्फ ऑपोजिशन लीडर्स का एक मीटिंग था जहां कई चीजों पे विचार हुआ है, तो इसमें आपका क्या
विष्णु जी, केसी सिंह जी का अपना इंटरप्रिटेशन हो सकता है, अपना एनालिसिस हो सकता है, मैं उससे कहीं ये नहीं कह रहा हूँ कि उनको इस तरह की बातें अच्छी बात लग रही है सुनने में, लेकिन सवाल ये है कि इस तरह की चीजें जो है, जैसे आपने भी बात कही अभी कि भाई चाय पीने के लिए अगर आप बैठे हैं तो मुझे नहीं लगता है कि इस तरह की चीज़ों को करने की कोई ज़रूरत है। इस तरह की चीज़ों को इतने हो हल्ला और इतने शोरगुल करके इस चीज़ को बताना और समझाना और मीडिया को फिर समझाना कि देखिए हम इस तरह के गठबंधन, अगर हम इस तरह के राजनीतिक अगर हम गैदरिंग कर रहे हैं तो उसका आशय जो है वो समझने
मतलब
की
आपको कह रहे हैं कि इसमें कुछ है, इसमें कोई पॉलिटिकल उद्देश्य है। आप ये कह रहे हो
कि अगर इसके पीछे अगर कोई राजनीतिक कारण कोई देशहित में नहीं है, मैं अगर इसको हिंदी का एक शब्द यूज करूं कि ये राजनीतिक हथकंडा हो सकता है, क्योंकि इस तरह की चीजों को इस देश में प्रयोग जो है कई बार किया गया लेकिन उसमें सफल लोग नहीं रहे। आपको याद हो कि अगर बोफोर्स के खिलाफ अगर कहीं कोई चीज गठबंधन बना, कोई मुद्दा होता है, कोई इशू होता है, आज ये किस मुद्दे को लेकर ये आएंगे, किस मुद्दे को लेकर ये
आपको कहना है कि कोई 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 मुद्दा नहीं है इस देश में?
क्या मुद्दा है आज, इनका क्या रोल है आज इन्होंने इस देश में?
ये सवाल शायद आपको पूछना पड़ेगा, पर मैं घनश्याम जी से ये पूछना चाहूंगा
कि हाँ आप हमारे कई मशिया हैं
जी। घनश्याम जी, द पॉइंट बीइंग मेंशनड इज दैट यू नो इफ देयर इज नो एजेंडा अकॉर्डिंग टू मिस्टर वर्मा इन द कंट्री एंड देयरफॉर योर मीटिंग सर्व्स नो पर्पस।
वेल, बीजेपी इज सो मेस्मराइज्ड एंड स्मिटन बाय देमसेल्व्स एंड देयर ओन लीडर्स दैट दे डोंट सी द हॉलोनेस ऑफ व्हाट दे आर सेइंग। The national agenda is something that relates to every child, every student, every youth, every woman, every farmer, everyone who's right now looking for a better life. When has BJP answered or anyone has answered a national agenda towards employment of the youth? Unemployment is at all-time high. It was at the meeting, there was a consensus that this nation has stalwarts, thinkers, political workers, leaders who can come together and present a better vision for how youth of this country will get employed, a better vision for how harmonious society can come together. We have left the farmers in the cold. There is a need for political leadership as well as social leadership to engage with farmers and ensure that we are not a nation where the largest farmers protest is happening out in the cold, okay, out in the sun, out in the rains. This is not a record that
structure, Ghanshyam ji? The fact is that it's all fine, these are political issues, we've heard them a million times. Is there not a need in this country to have a cohesive opposition right before the 2024 elections? 2024 is not very far away and there is no central opposition face, it appears at this juncture, who has united the opposition. All of you are doing is talking, but talking to what end? It just seems to be a dinner table conversation or a conversation over chai. Is this the beginning of a thought process, are you willing to say that, which could result in some sort of a front?
Absolutely. The foundation foundation of the forum going forward is to build this mission to set up the national agenda that involves political voices, social voices, and has a buy-in from political parties across the country, and set that on the table, an agenda that people connect with. This is not an agenda which is critique of Bharatiya Janata Party. It is an agenda which is the aspiration of the youth, the aspiration of the people.
Still, Ghanshyam, there's still no clear answers on where this is going. It is the aspiration of the youth and others. Fair enough. I need to wrap this up. I'd like to thank you all very much for being with us. Some would call this a damn squib of a meeting if there wasn't any larger objective. But perhaps you need to talk first before a larger objective can be sorted out. Thank you very much indeed. The Jet Airways revival plan submitted by a consortium of the London-based Calrock Capital and the UAE-based businessman Murari Lal Jalan has been approved by the National Companies Law Tribunal, according to sources who've spoken to us. As part of the revival plan, NCLT has reportedly given a number of days to the Directorate General of Civil Aviation, which goes into weeks actually, and the Aviation Ministry to allot slots to the airline. However, Jet Airways being given its important historic domestic and international routes remains somewhat unresolved, is what sources have told us. The airline had suspended operations on the 17th of April 2019 due to financial distress, but this is without doubt one of the most incredible turnaround stories in international aviation. We'll be joined by those who were a part of the airline earlier on, pilots and others. But for the moment, I'm joined by Ashish Chaucharia, the resolution manager, the man who very much engineered the entire process of giving wings to this airline once again. Ashish, this is just such a great day for you. You fought for this for more than a year. Were there occasions when you felt that there was no way it was going to happen?
Actually, Vishnu, it was more than 2 years. To be exact, it's 2 years and 2 days since the insolvency for the company was launched. And so we're extremely pleased, me and my entire team, to see this day today when the plan has now been approved by Honorable NCLT.
So the routes, I mean, that's, are you stuck on the issue of routes, or where does that lie?
Well, you know what, I think these slots and routes, as we all understand, and I think we had spoken about it earlier, is a very important part of the airline operation. Without the route, without these slots, where are the airplanes going to land? But at the same time, we must also see that for the airports, it's equally important to have airlines. So it is a mutually beneficial association. And I can tell you that in most of the airports in India, right now, the slots are not a constraint. I mean, even without the present COVID situation, I think, capacities are building, airports are expanding, the number of airports are rising. Yes, there are a few concerns about the airports in Mumbai and Delhi, where there are constraints, and where we are working alongside the airport authorities, the Civil Aviation Ministry, who have been incredibly cooperative.
You mentioned that there'll be a new runway which will come up in Delhi. So getting those routes...
That's right. We understand that there's a new runway coming up in Delhi, and that will add to the number of slots that are available. And of course, that means more capacity, more airlines.
So Ashish, the process of getting your routes back could take how long?
It actually announced that, the ministry and the officials and the ISRA should work together, and they've given them 90 days to work together. So I think, it can be expected that within 90 days, and if not, maybe still over a few more days, we should have a fair amount of clarity as to what slots are available or not available for Jet 2.0. But as I was mentioning earlier, that, there are slots available, and most of the airports have come back with a positive, response.
And how many of the Jet employees would the airline be willing to take back?
Vishnu, I think that is, an evolving, answer. It is not that you're going to start with 125 aircrafts as it used to be, before it went down. So as it picks up and it adds more aircraft to its fleet, it will require trained manpower. It will require, ground handlers, it will require pilots, crew. So they will be adding people as we move along. So I think there's certainly hope for the people who have, stuck on, have the faith on Jet Airways. And, going forward, we should hopefully be able to, employ as many more people.
How many aircraft will you start with, Ashish?
Well, right now, as the plans are evolving, the intent of the resolution applicant is that they want to start with at least, 20 narrow-bodied and 5 wide-bodied aircraft. Yes, it may not happen all at a snap, on day one, but it will be, in a short span is where we are, the applicants are thinking that they may be able to bring in these aircraft.
You mentioned bring in the aircraft. Will these not be a handful of existing aircraft that Jet continues to own in India?
Well, that's a good question, actually, because most of us who are flying in and out of Delhi and Mumbai must have seen aircraft parked on the tarmac. And, if you have noticed, and if you are an aviation enthusiast as I am, those aircraft, most of them are the wide-body aircraft.
Yes.
They're Boeing 777s and the Airbus 330s. Now, these aircraft are meant to be for long-haul flights. They are not economical to fly on short-haul anything less than, 5-6 hour range. So the plan, as we start as Jet 2.0, for the domestic routes, they will need to bring in, more aircraft, which would be the narrow-bodied aircraft. We have a couple of narrow bodies as well, you know, in India, in our possession, but those will need to be made airworthy as well. So while we have those aircraft, but certainly there'll be, you know, new aircraft which will be on its way.
So would it be fair to say that when you start off, you won't be flying internationally right off the top, or would there be a few international routes?
Well, actually, you know, there's no reason why they cannot fly, especially the short-haul international routes,
right.
You know, the neighboring routes. So because that you can fly even with the, you know, narrow-bodied aircraft, and you don't need that many passengers to fill it up. So subject to, of course, having the traffic routes from the ministry and also getting the slots and the airports on the other side, there's no reason why they cannot fly these routes. And given, you know, the current situation where we are, you know, as we emerge and fight this COVID pandemic, I think, you know, the aviation sector, the entire sector is going through an overhaul.
Yep.
So I feel that there would be more opportunities available, and it's an opportune time for, you know, today that the plan has been approved. You know, it gives enough runway for the company to do all the necessary actions, you know, to get its license active again, to get the aircrafts in, to get all the crew ready, and be ready to fly again as, you know, the traffic sort of builds up again as people get more confidence, you know, flying, you know, as they get vaccinated and we fight this.
Thank you so much, Ashish, for being with us. And I'll just have, you know, Captain Valiani, any reactions? You've heard the entire interview out now. Your thoughts now, what does this mean for people like you, professionals like you, who from day one have refused to give up hope?
Yes, Vishnu, like I mentioned, that it's a great news for all of us. It gives us a hope that, yes, Jet Airways will fly again. Jet Airways is going to be back in the skies. And, you know, people, there will be employees who are waiting to get back to their jobs. They will have their jobs back. So that's, and I know that it's difficult for everyone to be hired at this time. But, you know, at least to start with some.
Neha, are you excited at the prospect of flying again with Jet?
Well, Mr. Som, it's not me that I think entire Jet Airways family, to loaders, to cockpit crew, to engineers, or even the guests right now, they'll be delighted, excited, ecstatic, you know. I have right now, probably I'm running short of words. It's a beautiful moment, a very happy, enthusiastic moment, and very emotional at the same time, you know. So, yes, we are looking forward under the new leadership. It's going to be very challenging and interesting.
And exciting, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Amit, you know, maintaining the aircraft on the ground or through these last, it must have been extremely difficult. These planes weren't flying. They didn't have a license to fly as Jet. So how difficult was it to keep them operational? I mean, to keep them serviced, not operational.
Initially, I will tell you, on this very day 2 years back, we met Mr. Ashish Chaucharia. At this very time 2 years back, we were in a meeting with Mr. Chaucharia. He was having his first day in Siraya Center, headquarters of Jet Airways. And we put forward our plea to him that we need to maintain our aircraft because monsoon had approached at that time. And these are the only assets beyond the brand Jet Airways that we needed to maintain so that we could sell Jet Airways, actually, that the buyer could hope to buy something from Jet Airways. So it was extremely vital. And Mr. Chaucharia, and he knew the importance of these aircrafts, and he immediately formed an asset preservation team who have maintained and preserved the assets of this company. And I'm extremely thankful to the Ministry of Civil Aviation and DGCA especially, for having granted us approval, maintenance approval, to preserve these aircrafts, because during the time of closure, our approval for maintaining these aircrafts had been suspended. So with the efforts of Mr. Chaucharia and his team, and Mr. Rajesh Prasad, who is the Chief Strategy Officer of Jet Airways, they managed, through talks with DGC and within Ministry of Civil Aviation, they managed to revive partly our maintenance approval, and we could preserve this aircraft. Of course, there were challenges, but now that has become past now. Now we look forward to serve Jet Airways very soon and fly these aircraft.
Well, good luck with that. Let's hope it works out. Thank you so much for being with us. It is a fantastic day in Indian aviation. Jet Airways will be back flying again by the end of this year. 20 routes initially to start with. Some of them might be international, but primarily domestic routes. The routes themselves are being worked out. Within 90 days or so, there will be clarity on that. But Jet Airways is back. That's the headline story. I'd like to thank you all very much for being with us.